Good morning. This is Robert and Deborah White. We are in Durant, Oklahoma. This video is we're shooting this video for our GOZ acceleration group. We want to help you. We are Yahweh Ministries. We want to help you accelerate. So let me go ahead and start with some announcements. Once again, we are Yahweh Ministries. There's our address, P.O. Box 66, Durant, Oklahoma, 74702. We have a website, www.hiddentreasuresofwellness.com. So if you want to sow into this ministry, into this revelation, if you want to come into an alignment relationship, we have others that are. You can go to the website, scroll down, you'll see a video of me teaching on apostolic alignment. And also at the very bottom, not the donate bottom at the top, but the very bottom, you'll see a donate button where you can give online. So we also want to offer you a free gift. There's no gift required. We just want to sow this into your life like seed going in the ground. This is a book called A Time to Advance by Chuck Pierce, Apostle Chuck Pierce, and Drs. Robert and Linda Heidler. This book is about the times and seasons of God and about moving in His timing. God has a calendar. He has a way of doing things. He has an order. This is why when we get in God's timing, we can break off the enemy's access to our provision, to our bloodline, and bloodline curses and things that are operating in your blood and in your family literally begin to fall off. Coronavirus can't come near you when you're operating in God's timing. So we want to offer this book to you. If you'll contact us, we'll be glad to send it to you. There's also another book from Barbara Wintrobel. That's our apostle. That's who we're in alignment with. You'll hear me talk about alignment. This book is called The Wealth Creator. God didn't raise you up to be broke, to be busted and disgusted, to be possessed and oppressed, depressed, displaced. I mean, He didn't raise you up for all that, for you to be scraping and hunting down money. Okay? He didn't create, but He did create us to become wealth creators because He's given us power to get wealth. We'll send this book to you. There's no gift required. But I do encourage you to sow like seed in the ground in this revelation. All right, so we're going to move in with the teaching. Today I'm going to talk to you about the five tests that you must pass when you're going into the wilderness. Now, the material I'm going to be using is right out of a book by Dr. Chuck Pierce, Apostle Chuck. It's A Time to Defeat the Devil. So the Word of God is our foundation. But this is going to be a resource we're going to use so that we can understand that God did not raise me up to die in the wilderness. But He's raised me up to cross through the wilderness so I can get into our promises, which are great and precious promises in Jesus' name. So before we start that, let's open up with prayer. Father, we love You, we adore You, and we worship You. Precious Jesus, we thank You that You have made a way. When You went into the wilderness, You pioneered the breakthrough that we could walk in. And You went in the wilderness with power. And You came out with power. And You called us to go in with power and come out with power. And we thank You for it. We ask You to open the ears, that the ears will not pervert what the Word of God is saying. We thank You, Holy Spirit, for teaching this in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. So we also want you to prepare your communion elements. We've got the bread and the body and the blood prepared. So when we're coming to a completion, we're going to take communion with you so you have time to get your communion elements. When you're watching this YouTube training and video, you can hit pause and go get your communion elements. All right. So if you have your Bible, I invite you to open up in the book of Exodus. Now in the book of Exodus chapter 15, Moses is singing and worshiping the Lord God. And he's singing a song of celebration on how they were set free from Egypt. But they were set free from Pharaoh. In fact, he was underwater. Chariots and all of the armies that pursued them across the Red Sea, they drowned in the Red Sea. And God was bringing them to Sinai to get instructions, then for them to cross over into wilderness. Now, by the way, this is the same time in history, right before they left Egypt, that we had the first Passover. And we are all, as a church, in the wilderness right now, traveling through, traversing through our trials, but we are headed to Passover. Let me say it another way. We are going to be baptized in a new baptism at Pesach. And Pesach, or Passover, is a feast celebration that God is going to leap over into your future and pave a way for breakthrough for you and for me. Amen? Listen, Passover doesn't mean the death angel passed over. That's not what that means. It means to leap over or leap forward into your future. Okay? But before we can do that, there's five tests we have to pass. All right. So in chapter 15, he's singing to the Lord. Then in verse 20, then Miriam the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took the timbrel in her hand. And all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dances. And Miriam answered them, "Sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has thrown into the sea." This is a time to celebrate the goodness of the Lord, not bawl and squall for a roll of toilet paper. We are going to leap over. God's going to leap over everything in our future. Amen? All right. So, but they were going, this the time of worship. But while they were in the wilderness headed to Jordan, okay, now I'm fast forwarding. All right. Sinai experience, heading over to Jordan. All right. There were five tests. Now, the thing we must understand, if you need to write these things down, I would suggest you take notes. And if you don't get it the first time, watch the video. But God doesn't want you to live in the wilderness. He doesn't want you to wander in the wilderness. And he doesn't want you to die in the wilderness. What do you mean by live? Don't stay there. No, the wilderness is not for you to build a house and buy property and say, well, this is as good as it's going to get. No. It's a place of testing so we can get to the place of instruction. All right, now let's look at it. It's a place of transition. And as I said earlier, I was saying that they left Sinai. Actually, they were headed to Sinai. Yes. They left Egypt in the wilderness, but they were headed to Sinai. Now, the Sinai is the classroom. Sinai is the place of instruction. But they had to pass 5 tests to get to the place of instruction. Now, here's the why, because I've had people say, well, Apostle Robert, I just don't understand many things. Well, you got to pass these 5 tests, and understanding will come down on you. In other words, you're going to get delivered. Now, I love how Apostle Chuck does. Put your hand on your heart and say steady. Put your hand on your head and say straighten up. See, we got all this, these files up here that are wrong. And we just see things so wrongly. But we need, this is what this training's about, is to help us to shift out of religion. Okay. So, as they crossed over the Red Sea, I must embrace the baptism of deliverance and keep moving towards my destiny. So the first test in your study in the book of Exodus, when they came to the bitter water in the wilderness, they had to pass the test of murmuring and complaining. You're murmuring and complaining, bawling and squalling, and speaking negativity is, listen, all it is God says you haven't passed the test yet. And if you don't pass the test, you get to take it over. Okay? So don't be so quick to correct somebody else's speech if you yourself are still grumbling, murmuring, complaining. You know, murmuring, I looked it up, it's like a low, it's not loud complaining, it's not real loud, it's murmuring. It's under your breath where only maybe you or only someone real close to you can hear it. See, even Jesus dealt with the murmuring Pharisees. He said, you brood of vipers, you reason among yourselves. That's murmuring. Complaining is agreeing with the devil. And Father, we break that spirit of agreement with the devil. We're not going to murmur. We're not going to complain. We're going to speak faith. And we're also going to walk in wisdom in Jesus' name. Because I'm not living in the wilderness. I must not doubt God's goodness. Murmuring is a low-toned complaining. Unbelief, okay, here it is. Then there's murmuring, there's doubt, and unbelief is demonic Unbelief is demonic possession that comes into my spirit like a flood. I'm telling you, we cannot live in unbelief. Now listen, don't confuse faith with zeal. Or don't confuse zeal with faith. Your zeal will get you in trouble. Zeal doesn't get it. But the anointing of God coming down, we mix the promises of God with faith. Then we get wisdom when we pray in the Spirit. Okay. So the second test was after they had to pass this test of murmuring and complaining, which they didn't, but you will, was, by the way, we have to repent. So let's do it right now. Father, we repent as a body of believers for murmuring and complaining against the Lord. Then the next test was and you can read through this, was they went through the wilderness as they were going to Sinai, was the test in Elim. Elim was the test of blessing. What do you mean the test of blessing? When I'm blessed abundantly, will I stop and have a worship? Will I have an undignified worship session with the Lord? Or will I just over just like a child opening up Christmas presents. You tear the present open, you get it, and you go, "Where? What else is left?" See, he blessed them while they were on their journey in the world, and he was God was love. The Father loves to hear his children say, "Father, we just thank you right now for what you just did." Many times we're still looking at what we didn't get. We have to pass the test of the blessing and be in gratitude and thanksgiving, not for what we don't have, for what he has done. Because he is a good God and a good Father. In Jesus' name, Father, we repent. We're not thanking you for every little thing. Because you are so good, we know that you'll bless us with more, and we'll thank you for what we have. In Jesus' name. Then there was the wilderness and sin of sin, okay? In other words, there was a place called sin in the wilderness. I'm not talking about sinning in your heart. The place was called the wilderness of sin. And they found that there was no food. I must pass the test of believing in the promises of God. I must pass the test to believe that I don't have to murmur, bellyache, and cry out and bawl and squall for provision, but I can go and call the things that be not as though they are, thanking for provision. I can sow my seed in faith, and provision comes down in a moment. See, that's what the Father was wanting to pass, so they can, because when he brings them into war, see, by the way, he was dressing them for war. And I decree over you, God's dressing you for war right now, in a wartime season, that we're taking giants down. But he's not looking for a church that's scrambling for toilet paper. He's looking for the body of Christ that's dressed for war, hallelujah. Amen. We have got to get out of this begging and pleading for provision when it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. So they had to pass the test. I must continue to trust the Lord, for his mercies endure forever. Then there was the test of the Amalekites attacking. There was a place called Rephidim. Rephidim, the Amalekites attacked. The Amalekites had been ambushing the stragglers and the weak. We cannot stand by and watch our brothers and sisters be taken out by the Amalekites and the Midianites. See, the Amalekites and the Midianites would wait till Israel's provision was built up. Then they'd go in and they would continue. Now, not during the wilderness time, so much, but later they would continue to impoverish the people. I must pass the test of staying in faith during the battle. See, during the battle, the intercessors or the others alongside Moses, Joshua, Caleb, would hold the arms up of Moses and he would pray. We need to hold the arms up of the leaders and the apostles and the prophets that God has given us to serve. When you say, "I don't have an apostle and a prophet," you better get one fast. Because we're either going to be called for someone, we're either called to intercede as apostles and prophets, or we got a group holding our arms up. And we decree that the GOZ acceleration is holding Debbie and Robert's arms up as we intercede for you right now. Because when he interceded, Israel prevailed. When the arms came down, the Amalekites began to prevail. This is a prophetic picture of a test that must be passed. What's the test, Apostle Robert? That you will hold our arms up. That we're going to hold up Barbara's arms. That the glory of Zion and those intercessors are going to hold up Apostle Chuck Pierce's arms. See, this acceleration group, depends on you holding up our arms. And we do it with prayer. We do it with our giving. This is your opportunity to pass the test. If you don't pass the test, you're going to stay in the wilderness. By the way, and you listen, you'll be wondering there. When you stop your giving, you start wondering. Then you could die there. Hey, you don't want, this word is right on. You can study it for yourself. Only two people out of 1.5 million crossed over. Because they said, I'm not going to wonder. I'm not going to live there. And I'm definitely not going to die there. And Caleb in his 80s said, give me my mountain. Okay. I must respond in faith with all five tests. I must pass the test of staying in faith during the battle. The five wilderness tests keep us moving towards the exceedingly great and precious promises. Or we can miss our destiny. Now, Israel missed their destiny. But Jesus. Somebody say, but Jesus. See, Jesus paid the price so I can take the test over again. Israel couldn't take it again. All those that refused to shift, they died. And he said, your carcasses will rot out there. But these carcasses don't have to rot. Because we can repent and say, Lord, I'm going to pass these tests. I'm not going to bellyache and complain. Let me go through them right now, real quickly. I'm going to get my baptism. I'm not going to bellyache and complain. I'm going to celebrate you, Lord. Number two, I'll celebrate you when the blessing's in front of me for every little miracle. Number three, I'm not going to say, what am I going to eat next? What am I going to wear? Because I'm going to celebrate you, I'm going to sow, and we're not letting anybody go without because our Father says, I'm not letting anybody go without. Number four, I'm not going to bellyache and complain that there's no water at Rephidim. Why? Because I've got the Holy Ghost. I'm going to trust the Lord for His mercies endure forever. And number five, I'm going to hold up the arms of the leaders, Lord, that You put in our path for instruction, for mentoring, for apostolic alignment. I'm going to thank You, Lord, for all of that. And Father, we repent for our stubbornness not to pass the five tests. We will all pass the test. Please forgive us and cleanse us with Your blood. Take Your elements in Your hand with me. Lord, we thank You for Your body, because Your body was broken and ripped to shreds so the body of Christ would pass the five tests in the wilderness. We receive Your body in Jesus' name. And Lord, we thank You for the blood. You have washed us from the inside out. We thank You that we have the resurrection power of Jesus Christ to break through and do what God's called us to do in the earth realm. Lord Jesus, we remember Your blood in Jesus' name. Well, we celebrate You. We are in joy right now and thanksgiving. This new media platform. We're not going to be in fear of coronavirus or any virus, but we're going to walk in wisdom. We're not going to buck the governing authorities. Romans chapter 13 says that they have been sent for us by God. We're going to let God do what he wants to do. He is taking a plow and plowing up all the religions of this world. He's plowed them under right now to put the focus on redemption and revival. And we need to cooperate with it. We love you. We celebrate you. Father, I loose the blessing of passing the 5 tests so we can go to the place of the classroom of instruction. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you that we're moving and accelerate towards Passover. And we will worship you and we will receive breakthrough instruction in a new way in Jesus' name. So this is your opportunity to accelerate. Watch the video, watch the training video. Move in that anointing, move in that breakthrough. Pray in the Spirit. Read your Bibles. Come on. Contact us. We'll be glad to help you keep your gift moving. We love you, and we're going to continue to help you keep moving. The Marketplace Multipliers, we're going to another platform of a Zoom call. If you're interested in Marketplace Multipliers, by the way, God's not just in the church house. He's in the business world. If you want to see, if you're tired of trying to make money and chase the dollar, then I'm going to say to you, God has a better way. It's called the kingdom. You can contact us about the Marketplace Multipliers, where you put you let Jesus borrow your boat, then the fish or the money comes running to you. The contracts come running to you. The new clients come running to you. Come on. Out of debt in 7 to 5 years. Some of you are strapped with debt. And God is shaking you up saying, will you please listen to me? I'm going to say to you right now, with all that's going on around us, being in debt is the worst thing you could do. This is just a warning for us as the body of Christ. Not one Christian should still stay in debt. And Father, I loose it over them that they'll come on board with the Marketplace Multipliers and understand God has a kingdom way to unlock their destiny and provision in Jesus' name. This is Robert and Deborah signing off. We'll talk to you soon. God bless you.